Namaste. And in the tradition of my ancestors, I want to say Ram Ram, Sita Ram. This is how our ancestors that came from India to the Caribbean, this is how they greeted each other, you know, regardless of which sampradaya and so on they belong to. It was a universal greeting. So I want to share that with you from on behalf of my ancestors. So Mr. Muhammad, welcome to this interview. I am Pandita Indrani Ramprasad from Trinidad and Tobago. And we are interested in finding out more about the Ram Mandir issue, because as you know, Ram is very dear to many people around the world. And for you, it is an archaeological, scientific kind of exploration that you would have gone into. So we wanted to find out from you, the expert in that region of archaeology, in that discipline of archaeology, some details around the issue. So I invite you now, Mr. Muhammad, to please introduce yourself to the world.
Yeah. Well, my name is Muhammad KK. I come from Kerala, and I belong to a community, Muslim community known as Mapila Muslim Community. It is a crossbreed of the native ladies of Kerala, coastal Kerala, and Arab traders. So our fathers were mostly Arabs. They came to Kerala for trade purpose, married here, and then the generation known as Mapilas. So I belong to that Muslim community of Kerala. So we don't know, naturally, we don't know Urdu, Hindi, and other thing. But my education was in Aligarh Muslim University, which is in North India, in Uttar Pradesh. So I picked up both Hindi and Urdu. And then after the completion of my MA in history, I joined for archaeology because I was deeply interested in archaeology. So I joined for archaeology in Delhi. There was a small course known as, it was a 2 years course. And during my time, it was 1 year course only. That is a postgraduate diploma in archaeology. I completed that one. So for the postgraduate diploma in archaeology, we have to have go to an archaeological site and train ourselves as a field archaeologist. So that training was in Ayodhya. So that is how I am connected with Ayodhya. And then later on, I was posted in Aligarh Muslim University as assistant archaeologist. I could make a number of very important discoveries. The first discovery was the discovery of Akbar's Ibadat Khana. Akbar was a very important king in India. After Ashoka, he was the most important person. And he wanted to bring all the religion, all the people of religions into one single harmonious hall. So for that, he established a kind of debating school. A debating school means each person representing a religion, he would come and speak about the merit of their own religion. He listened to them, and ultimately he evolved a new religion known as Deen-e-Ilahi. So that was the nursery of Indian secularism. I had the privilege of exploring and excavating that particular place. And then Akbar had a Christian chapel also, because when the Christian fathers came from Europe, Akbar, for their residence, he set up a small chapel and a residential portion. That was the first Christian chapel of North India. Not South India. In South India, we had in 52 AD, in Kerala, a place known as Cranganur, there was a Christian church. But the first Christian church of North India that was set up at Fatehpur Sikri. So I had the privilege of excavating that also.
What year would that be? It'd be held, if you can give us some the times.
Yes, Akbar, I mean, these people came to Fatehpur Sikri, that is Father Rudolf Akavaiva and Father Montserrat. These were the two important fathers who had come from Italy. Father Rudolf was from Italy and Father Montserrat was from Spain, Spanish man. So both of them came to Fatehpur Sikri. They tried to convert Akbar. But Akbar was a completely different person. He believed in all the religions, so he could not be converted. But for their residence, Akbar had built a small church. That also I could excavate. Then I could also excavate a number of Buddhist stupas. Lord Buddha, after his demise, at various places, his followers, they had set up a number of Buddhist stupas. So of them, in Bihar, there are two very important stupas. One is at Rajgir. Rajgir was a very important center of Buddhism. So that stupa I could excavate. And then there was another stupa that is known as Kesariya stupa, which is, of course, a proto, type of the Borobudur stupa. Borobudur stupa in Indonesia is a World Heritage Monument. But the prototype of that stupa was built in Bihar, a place known as Kesariya. So that also I could excavate. And then my main field of activity was when I came to Archaeological Survey of India, it was the conservation of the monuments. And some of the most important monuments, like a temple known as Bateshwar, where there were dacoits also, some unlawful persons, dacoits of the area. So I had a personal discussion with all those people and got them on my right side. And then I could reconstruct 80 temples at one place. That is known as Chambal Valley. Chambal Valley is a very dreaded place. But again, I had the privilege of walking into forbidden lands, and then reconstruct 80 temples. That is a record thing. Wow. For which I could later on, I got a number of awards from the government of India. And the most notable award was Padma Shri. That is the fourth civilian award given to a person. Mostly the government servant, they don't receive it. But I too got it after my retirement. But that was a record work. So in this way, as an archaeologist, I could work in the field of exploration and excavation also, and at the same time, conservation of the work also. So this is in nutshell what I am.
So how many years after you graduated and you started working hands-on archaeological digs and so on, how many years of experience would you say you had under your belt when you started to look at the Ram Mandir?
Yeah. As an archaeologist, I started having my training in 76, 77. And right from 1978 onwards, I was working as an archaeologist. So that way, I have got near about 40 years of experience till now.
Wow.
42 years of experience. And in service, of course, it was 32 years.
Remarkable.
And that was mainly fully devoted for this exploration and excavation. And also at the same time for the conservation of the monuments. And the best part of my life was, because I had an abiding interest in the life of the marginalized people, downtrodden people. So when I was in Delhi, I used to, along with my official work, because I was mainly working at that time for preparing the monuments for the Commonwealth Games that was in 2010. So at that time, because, you know, there were thousands of laborers working under me, and I arranged for the schooling of the children of the workers who were working at various places. So that was a great initiative which I had taken up at that time.
Wonderful.
Get into the group of those people, unprivileged people, and do whatever you can for the upliftment of the community. That way I ran 4 schools in various parts of Delhi, which of course received a lot of attention because an award was given to me by Amitabh Bachchan.
Wow.
The greatest film hero of Kerala.
Yes.
India.
All know him all over the world.
Yes, all over the world.
Yes.
Yeah. So the award was given to me by him, so it became very well known. And then when American President Obama in 2010, he visited Humayun's tomb. I was his guide. And at the same time, he expressed a desire that he would like to meet these children. This underprivileged children. So there were certain objections from the official circles. But the American embassy said, no, the president would like to meet these children. And then I arranged a program also. And he was the happiest man, Barack Obama and Michelle Obama. They were the happiest persons when they met these children. And that was a great opportunity for the children also. So my school that way became very well known. It was not that kind of built school. It was a tended school because in the monuments like Qutub Minar, Red Fort, we have got certain rules and regulations are there. You cannot have any new constructions. So we were running this kind of canvas schools. Wherever the work is going on, the children also would be there. So there I will be setting up a school. So it became very well-known school. And then I have made a replica museum also in Delhi. Replica museum, a person who is coming to Delhi, he may not be having an opportunity. He will be seeing mainly in Delhi only the Sultanate and Mughal monuments. That is Qutub Minar, Red Fort. All these are Mughal monuments or Sultanate monuments. Go to Agra, you have the same monuments. Taj Mahal, Agra Fort, Fatehpur Sikri. Go to, then the in this one, if you go to Golden Triangle, that is Jaipur, there you can call it Rajput monument, but essentially with domes, arches, minarets, they are also Islamic monuments. But what is the real India? The great Ajanta, Ellora, Elephanta, Mahabalipuram, Brahadishara Temple, the great Sarnath Buddha, all these things, you know, people, they don't get an opportunity. So for them, in an area at Siri Fort Auditorium, just behind it, I set up a museum, which is known as a replica museum. So if you go to that museum, there you will be having the replicas of the masterpieces of Indian art. So within 1 or 2 years, hours, you know, you can see the total India. So my original program was to have an Asian museum. That is from Far East Asian countries, from Southeast Asian countries. Thus, the best pieces would be displayed there. So these are, a kind of activity. It was not my original work. It was not part of my original, this one also. But at the same time, I had an abiding interest in the downtrodden people also. And this kind of replicas also. And because of that interest, you know, I took initiative. And all of them, the dreams could be implemented in its totality. So again, in a nutshell, I am a man who is taking a lot of interest in these kind of activities also.
Okay, so we We now look at your work with the Ram Mandir, and to tell us here out in the diaspora, the issues that surrounded the Ram Mandir and the archaeological data and evidence that you have regarding Ram Mandir.
See, this was in 1977-78, I participated in the excavation under Professor B.B. Lal. Professor B.B. Lal is an eminent historian who was earlier the Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, a very eminent person. So I had my training under him. So we were just staying just outside the controversial mosque at that time. So before excavation, we take up an exploration work just to contextualize the archaeological excavation. So as part of that, we went into that controversial mosque also. So there was at that time, you know, there was a police, I mean, people, they were guarding the gate. So they stopped us also, but we told them, see that we had nothing to do with the other political things. But we are research people and we have come here for the research work.
So what you call the controversial mosque is actually the site of the Ram Mandir? Is that what?
Yes, exactly. Okay. The structure of Ram Mandir.
Okay,
the structure of the mosque. The structure of the mosque at that time.
Right.
So when we went inside, we saw the temple pillars that has been reused for the mosque. Then the question comes, you know, how do you say that these are the temple pillars or the mosque pillars? So in 11th and 12th century, all the temple pillars, they would be having at the lowest part of that pillar, there would be this one that is Purna Kalasha that is inscribed there. Purna Kalasha. What is a Purna Kalasha? Purna Kalasha is a Sanskrit word. It is a vase from which foliages would be coming out. So that is a symbol of prosperity in Hinduism. Like swastik. Swastik is another symbol. Two fishes, that is another symbol. Are the half crescent, that is another symbol. So there are Ashtamangala Chinnas. 8 auspicious symbols are there. So this was also one such symbol. So if anybody has got any doubt, you know, they can go to Qutub Minar even now. You have a number of this one pillars having the carving of this one, that is Purna Kalasha. This is the carving of Purna Kalasha. And there you have a number of this one also, sculptures also, Hindu deities also, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, all of them are there in a very mutilated condition. I'm talking about Quwwat al-Islam Mosque in Delhi. So similarly,
sorry, I didn't hear that. Which mosque is it?
It is known as Quwwat al-Islam Mosque in Delhi, just by the side of Qutub Minar.
Okay.
Just by the side of Qutub Minar. So, I mean, this kind of things has already happened. That was a medieval period. Many things have happened. People have killed thousands of people. They have appropriated temples also. Nobody should deny all these things. These are the historical facts. So, we saw this kind of pillars. And then on the west side of this mosque was excavated, because, you know, the mosque was standing just outside the mosque when we excavated. There we got the brick bases on which the pillars were standing. The brick bases on which these pillars were standing. 12 pillars were already there. That was reused. But just outside this one, there are pillar bases also. And then a number of Hindu sculptures also. Normally, if it is a Muslim mosque area, you will never get sculptures, because you know, any depiction of any kind of living being is prohibited in Islam. So you cannot have idols, you cannot have sculptures, you cannot have terracotta sculptures also in Islamic monuments. So all these things were there. So it was not an issue at that time, because you know, people did not take it very, very seriously also. But right from 1988 onwards, some of the Marxist historians like Irfan Habib, Romila Thapar, then Dr. Sharma, all of them made it an issue. And they gave a statement also in the press saying that the area has been excavated by Professor B.B. Lal and he has not got anything associated with the Hindu temples, which was a lie. Wow. It was a factual lie. They are not, none of them were archaeologists. Irfan Habib is not an archaeologist. R. Sharma is not an archaeologist. Romila Thapar is not an archaeologist.
But may I ask you, as historians, are they specialists in this area of the that you were excavating that period?
Not at all. Not at all. They have no competence. They have no domain competence to speak on archaeology. But you know, they had a lot of press connection with Times of India, with various newspapers. So they went with went to almost all the press and it was widely published also.
What would have been their motivation for that? What would have motivated historians?
I think there could be, because, you know, yes, I mean, the political motivation, of course, was there, because most of them were communist historians. So communist historians, they have got their agenda also and widely connected also. And the historians, opposed to them, the liberals historians and historians opposed to them, they were not having this kind of wide connections. So that was the reason. But Professor B.B. Lal, he defended himself and he gave a rebuttal also. And he said, no, we have excavated and we have got number of antiquities which associated with a temple structure, and the temple structure, the pillars are also there, the pillar bases are there, and apart from both these things, a number of terracotta sculptures also we have got it from there. And I gave a statement, because I was in Archaeological Survey of India at that time. I was deputy superintending archaeologist in Tamil Nadu at that time. I said, gave a statement that I was the only Muslim who had participated in the excavations. And I have seen the temple pillars with my own eyes. And I have seen those pillar bases also. And I have seen the other sculptures also excavated from there. And there was, of course, a temple before the mosque. That was my first statement. And then I said, apart from that, this place, Rama Mandir, is as important for Hindus as Makkah and Medina are for Muslims. So the Muslim community should willingly hand it over for the construction of a magnificent Hindu Rama temple. That was my second part of my statement. So this was widely published. And Indian Express published it in all its editions also. So that was a kind of setback for this archaeologists, for these historians who were not archaeologists. So and they could not even reply.
Yeah, I was just about to ask you, did they have a response?
Yeah. No. Because how can they respond? Because none of them were the archaeologists. And none of them had gone to the site also. They had not seen the site. And it was without seeing the site, without having the domain competence of the subject. They were passing on their opinion. And that was published by these newspaper people also. So it's not only the historian equally the newspaper people were also equally responsible for the kind of chaos and confusions created by them. So there was,
there was some kind of political motivation then in wanting to deny the Hindus this site. But the other question I have is, would Muslims, is it not haram for Muslims to worship in a place that has, like you say, these murti figures and where a mandir once stood? Isn't it haram?
Yes. It is haram. It is prohibited in Islam. Not only that, according to Islamic, Quranic verses, you cannot dismantling the Hindu icons and temples, you cannot even abuse it, a Hindu god or any gods other than that of Allah. He cannot abuse. There is a Quranic verse, La tasubbu alladhina yad'una min dunillah. You cannot abuse, its meaning is that you cannot abuse the gods of people who are worshipping other than Allah. So that is a clear injunction of the Quran. So it is against the Quranic verses. And also occupying this kind of things, of other people, that is also against Islamic principles. So, you just cannot, Muslims cannot defend all this. And Muslims were, many of the Muslims, because I was in Aligarh Muslim University at that time, and many of the Muslims wanted to settle the issue also by handing over the structure. But it was this Irfan Habib and this coterie, that is the Marxist lobby, that misguided the Muslim community and reached this kind of, to Muslims, at last they had to come to a juncture where it became very difficult for them to rescue themselves. So that for that also, for misguiding the Muslim community, these communist historians are responsible. So that was the first thing. So at that time, again, these people said, no, there is nothing. They did not respond to me because, they had no arguments at all. And then they said, no, there are remains and other things. Publicly they would not say, but they persuaded certain people. So the second excavation under Dr. B.R. Mani was conducted in order to settle that issue also.
What year was that?
That was in the year 2003 under Dr. B.R. Mani. And Dr. B.R. Mani is a very seasoned archaeologist. So these people said that below the mosque, not only the mosque was constructed on a virgin land. Below that, there was neither a Hindu temple, nor a Muslim structure also, nor a Buddhist structure.
That was a Marxist historian said.
They publicly said, on record they said.
Tell me something about the composition of the team that went
I'll come to that one. Great. So it was on record they said. But when when a survey of the area was conducted, that is ground GPR survey, that is a ground penetrating survey, radar survey was conducted. It was very well known, there are structures below the mosque. What the Marxist historians were saying was, there are no structures at all. Neither Hindu, nor Muslim, nor Christian. Nothing at all. But, in the radar survey, they were proved wrong. And then the second stage was excavation of that area. And when it was excavated, that was another surprise. We had found, during the first excavation, we had seen only 12 pillars. But now, when Dr. B.R. Mani is excavated, he could get the pillar basis of more than 50 pillars. 50.
Wow, wow.
That too in 17 rows.
Wow.
In 17 rows. Proving that we were right. We were correct. And those people were wrong. And that was a kind of false information which they were spreading also at that time.
So didn't the
and
media...
not only that,
the media didn't cover all of this, the new findings?
Media, occasionally, some of them covered, some of them would not cover, because you know, media was always on their side. Mostly they are on their side, except some Hindi papers and other things. And then we got near about 263 pieces of sculptures. That was another great thing. And then in every temple, you know, you would be having this pranala. Pranala is a gargoyle through which the abhishega jala, because in every day, on every day, you had to wash the main deity. And that abhishega jala, that is the water, that would be going through a gargoyle. So that gargoyle, this is known as makara pranali. What is Magara? Magara means that would be a crocodile. It would be having a crocodile face. And that would be always towards north. So this Magara Pranali, if it is again a Muslim mosque, you would never get a crocodile face from that area. It was a crocodile-faced Magara Pranali which was excavated from there. And then, as I said, 263 pieces of sculptures, including that of a dog, including that of a serpent. So all these things were excavated from there. Had it been a mosque area, you would never have got all these kind of figures, because all of them are harams as per the Islamic law. And then there was an inscription of 20 lines also, which very clearly said it is known as Vishnu Hari Shila Phalak. So that very clearly said that this Vishnu temple is dedicated to that Vishnu who has killed Bali. So the question comes, who has killed Bali? That is Sri Ram. And who has killed 10-headed person? Who is that 10-headed person? Of course, Ravana. So, and apart from that, a number of architectural, this one, members of the temple, like Amalka, Kalasha, a number of architectural parts of the Shikara, and of various parts of the temples were also excavated, which conclusively proved that there was a huge and a very grand, magnificent temple there below the mosque.
So you're saying that argument, you're saying there was that inscription that saying that this temple is dedicated to that form of Vishnu, that is Rama?
That this is dedicated to that person, that Vishnu, who has killed Bali. So who has killed Bali? This is Sri Rama. Who has killed 10-headed person? That is Sri Rama. So it is obvious.
And this is underneath the very temple that we call Ram Mandir. And this is what the Marxist historians refuse to acknowledge as evidence?
You know, they refuse to acknowledge all these kind of things, you know. They refuse to acknowledge. Because, you know, basically, they are not trained in archaeological excavation. They have read about archaeology, but they don't have any kind of field experience at all. Naturally, they should not have come out without knowing the subject. But that was their habit. And our archaeologists, they were also not very articulate. They were not articulate. They should have come out with all these things, you know. But most of them were government officials. So a government official, they would not speak also. That is another biggest problem in India. And while the case was, every day the case was being heard in the Supreme Court of India, I knew Irfan Habib very well. Because, you know, for 10 years, I fought, while I was in Aligarh Muslim University, I fought with this person. So I knew that while the court case was going on, just to prejudice some of the judges, you know, he would come out with certain gimmicks because, you know, he's a person who uses this kind of gimmicks. So I knew that he would be coming out. So, and he also said, you know, I mean, their group said that this time the excavation team is being led by a Hindu. So his report should not be taken into consideration. And there are certain things, you know, which we as archaeologists, we know, but we don't divulge it. So I gave a statement which was of 6 columns in terms of India. I gave all the evidences in support of the temple. And my most smashing evidence was against this Marxist people historian. I said that the report which was prepared by Dr. B.R. Mani, this is not only by him. And this was a co-authored by 4 Muslim archaeologists. They had earlier said, you know, this was the report was prepared by Dr. B.R. Mani, who is a Hindu. So this report should not be accepted by the Honorable Supreme Court. So I argued, no, it should be totally, because Archaeological Survey of India is neither a party with this group nor a party with that one. And moreover, this report was not only prepared by Dr. B.R. Mani, its co-authors were 4 other Muslim archaeologists, well-known archaeologists of Archaeological Survey of India. And then I gave their names also, because, you know, that was the biggest slap on their face. I said that it was Ghulam Hussein Khaja. Number one, he is a reputed archaeologist and he retired from Nagpur as director of Muslim and Christian, Arabic and Persian epigraphy. The second person, that is Dr. Atiqur Rahman Siddiqui, he retired from Agra. He was a member of the excavation team along with B.R. Mani, and he was also one of the co-authors of the report submitted by Dr. B.R. Mani. And the third one was, you know, Zulfikar Ali. Zulfikar Ali is, even now, he is working in Archaeological Survey of India in Chandigarh Circle. And the fourth person, Dr. Hashmi, he was working, he retired from Bhopal Circle. So all these persons were, eminent archaeologists, not simple archaeologists, eminent archaeologists. And the report was co-authored by these people. So that was a kind of bombshell for those people, because, you know, they did not know all this detail. Nor the public, they also did not know this thing. So when I divulged all these things, you know, many Muslim scholars, they rang up me personally to know whether this is correct or not. So I told them it is 100% correct. That is why I have given the names of all these people also. Because nobody knew. Other than our archaeologist fraternity, nobody knew all this thing. So that was a kind of bombshell for those people. And they could not reply. The only way, they sought to reply for me, by saying that I was not in the, because it was also, I was not in the excavation team conducted by Professor B.B. Lal. So that was again a false statement. Because, you know, such false statement before being issued, the Times of India, they should have sought my own remarks also, but they did not do it. So I find something in the hand of some of the reporters of the Times of India in that one. So as per the ethics of a newspaper, they should have sought my remarks also. What is your reaction to it? Which they did not see. And then I had to contact Professor B.B. Lal. He was in America at that time. Then he sent a rebuttal to all these things, which Times of India was forced to publish. No, K.K. Mohammed was there during the excavation with me, and he was a member of my team. And that was also, they were forced to publish. Otherwise, they would not have published that also. So you have to face all these kinds of problems in order to prove what is right and what is wrong.
Yeah, I'm just stunned. I am just stunned. The pursuit of truth is lost in these academic circles of these Marxist historians. It's lost. It's a manipulation of facts for political reasons, and that's such a dangerous thing in a society like India with so many different identities. You know, it's remarkable. Lost. I'm at a loss for words.
Yeah. So this was a kind of manipulation, you know, the worst kind of manipulation, where the biggest, I mean, they call themselves historians and archaeologists, you know, and indulge in all this kind of manipulations, virtual manipulation of each and everything. And one has to reply we don't reply also, but it was for the first time. I had the opportunity to give them a rebuttal and rebuff also. And our submissions were later on accepted by the Honorable Supreme Court of India also. And that was the judgment, you know, that has shown that whatever ASI had put forward, that was right, that was correct, and that is according to the specification wanted by the Honorable Supreme Court.
So I have a question for you on,
yeah,
if such wrong data was given to the Supreme Court, what was their response to this kind of manipulation of data before them? Were these people held responsible?
They should have been held responsible. At least the Aligarh Muslim, because a sizable section of the people who came with the wrong data was from Aligarh Muslim University. Dr. Ali Nadeem Rizvi, he was behind all this attempt, apart from Irfan Habib, because he supplied the wrong data to Times of India also, and Times of India is also party to that. The reporter is party to that. Otherwise, you know, they would not have published it like this one without seeking my own rebuttal, my reactions. So when it was published, you know, that Aligarh Muslim University and the Ministry of Education, they should have taken action against this Ali Nadeem Rizvi and other people, which they did not do. They should have taken it. And even now they can take it. Otherwise, you know, this kind of, they will make it into a business. They have already made it into a business, you know, and crafting this kind of lies. I mean, they have become experts in that field. So if you want to stop all these things, you know, action should be taken against this kind of Marxist historians.
You know, the Supreme Court of India is held in very high esteem around the world.
Yes.
You know, I usually read their remark. They're just astounding, you know, the intellectual minds we hold in very high esteem. So tell us more about after your team was able to prove that this is the site of the Ram Mandir, how was it settled? How was the tension between the misinformation that guided some people and the, you know, the determination by some to reclaim what, as you say, is like a Mecca to Muslims, and for them this is their Ram site. How did that play out?
Muslims community, as I told you, Muslims were ready to hand it over. But you know, they were misguided by these communist historians. So when you misguide, you know, because you know a prominent historian is saying that there was no temple, most of the Muslim would say, see, I mean, he is saying that there are no temples. But they don't know what is the difference between a historian and an archaeologist. So these people, I mean, on a party basis, they were misguiding the Muslim community. So Muslim community, after the judgment, Muslim community, because, you know, they have enough release from all these things. because they also wanted that kind of settlement. A settlement should be there. Muslims were also looking for that kind of settlement. And even now, because, you know, even after the this one settlement and the judgment also, Irfan Abi was not ready to accept the court judgment also. He went to the extent that this should be reviewed and all those, we should go to the higher court and higher benches. They tried for that all. But the Muslim community this time, they did not go to the court, except few people. And that was also, finally, they also thought, no, that is better not to go. And let us, I mean, whatever is the decision, let us accept the verdict of the Honorable Supreme Court. So that way, that this one, they became wiser. And now I don't think, you know, they would be, I mean, accepting the views of Professor Irfan Abi. At least he has been exposed now. And the whole Marxist group. And it is for the first time. Otherwise, you know, for some times what they used to do is they would be supporting the Hindu community. And the Hindu community would say, oh, here is a great professor. Let us go with him. And then he would be changing his track. He would go to the Muslim community. That is what he has done in Aligarh Muslim University. Because as seen, there were a lot of agitations in Aligarh Muslim University against Professor Irfan Abi. And at that time, BJP was with him. BJP was with him at that time. And then it was only from 1988 onwards, BJP became against Irfan Abi. Otherwise, they were the supporters of Irfan Abi earlier, from 1980 onwards. So I have seen all these things there in the university. Because I was in the university. Yeah.
Remarkable how politics, religion, and truth. Yes. Where's the truth in all of this? I'm looking at it from the academic historians who are not experts in archaeology, but are making statements, about this is just remarkable. And you sit in the middle of all of this.
Yes, I was a liberal man even at that time. So because, you know, you should not go to that kind of extreme group of people, whether it is Hindus or Muslims. So that is what is happening now. I mean, if you are a liberal, there will be nobody to support you except some few people, you know. There won't be anybody to support you. You will have neither political support also, nor the other intellectual support also. So that is the bane of a liberal person in India.
Oh, wow. So, in closing, would you like to say, your closing comments about perhaps where you'd like to see this go in the future, and both for the Hindu and the Muslims living in that area, in terms of harmony? And so would you like to close with that?
See, this one submission was, you know, because we should have, after the demolition of the temple and after the judgment also, we should have done further excavation in the whole area. Because now the court has given a final judgment. So we should have used this opportunity to fully excavate the entire place. That should have been there. Then there should have been an underground museum there. An underground museum of all the objects excavated from that area. That should have been set up. And then the rest of the area and beyond the core area, they should have developed it like Akshardham Temple in Delhi. Akshardham Temple is a place where once you go there, they have then done the exhibitions and other things remarkably well. There are many shows, you know, that really gives you courage and that gives you an insight into the achievement of our ancient India. Achievement of ancient India means, I mean only the scientific achievement of ancient India, not the mythological thing. Because an extreme Hindu, sometimes he would go that Ram was many lakhs of years before. An archaeologist would not believe that one. And some people would say, we had Pushpaka Vimana at that time. An archaeologist is not going to believe that one. Or Ganesh surgery, an archaeologist is not going to believe. Or we had internet in ancient time, an archaeologist is not going to believe. Or you can use, extract gold from this one cow's milk. So these are the kind of things, you know. By using these things, you know, these Marxist historians, they attack you.
Yeah, because that's a deliberate, on their part, it's a deliberate demonization of the the ancient Indian sacred narratives. Those narratives were telling a story of creation and so on in a different way than science would. You know, so we got to use both of them. So I agree with you. While scientifically we may not accept some of these, because they were not meant to be. They were sacred narratives. Telling their story in a different way.
Yes. And you know, these kind of mythologies are there in Egyptian civilization, in Mesopotamian civilization, in Greek civilization, in Chinese civilization. But the problem is none of them come to a scientific forum and say, so we had this, we knew about internet, we knew about this Pushpaka Vimana.
Yes.
None of them come. But we does that mistake.
Yes.
We do that mistake.
So what's your prognosis for Ram Mandir? When is it expected to be completed? I know they have started, right?
They have already started it, and I think by 2023 or 24 they would be able to complete it. At the whole construction part of it, I mean, they would be able to complete it. But you know, the whole area, because now you have got more than 67 acres of area land, and then there is no water problem because of the Sarayu River is just by the side of it. So whole, you have to develop it in such a way that you have to have many theme parks. You have to have a very good exhibition about the achievement of Indians in the ancient world in a very scientific way. Again, I emphasize on that scientific thing, not mythological thing. So that kind of this should, when you go to that area, that should spiritually elevate you. And also, your own, because you know, I mean, we had such an ancient past, glorious past to us there, and that should be revived. So it should be an area and it should be a center in order to rejuvenate us. So unless it rejuvenate you and raise you up, you know, then if you are not able to do that, then it is not going to serve a very big purpose. So we have to pool in people who have got their own innovative thinking, and then bring to a kind of this one level where we should be able to reconstruct all these things and narrate the story also. Right. A story narration is very essential, and that too, it should be a scientific story narration. That is very essential in that idea.
So, Mr. Mohammed, I'm so very delighted to have heard from you directly, person directly involved, because outside of India, we don't know the whole story. And as you say, the media itself has been compromised by the Marxist historians who have manipulated this information. So I'm very, very delighted. And I want to say thank you so much for putting this in perspective for us, giving us the facts so we decide ourselves. You know, the pursuit of truth is really the highest goal that we in all areas of endeavors. So I want to thank you so much. Would you like to close with any special ending?
Yes, most welcome. Thank you so much for giving me an opportunity to speak to people from outside the country.
Thank you again. Okay. Namaste from Trinidad and Tobago, out in the Caribbean, West Indies, where we play the best cricket.
Oh, great.
Thank you, G. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Welcome. Yeah, bye.